Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to our Link and Learn session on AML KYC. My name is Bastien Collette. I'm director within the AML team in Deloitte Luxembourg. And today we will present the agenda of today will be the register of beneficial owners for registered entities, meaning the Luxembourg experience, the beneficial owner registers in Ireland, a global view on AML CTF enforcement, as well as the key element of the CSSF circular 18698 on AML CTF obligation for investment fund managers. And we will end this presentation by the key element of the fifth AML EU directive. Today, I'm with my colleagues, Hélène Fossé, consultant also in the AML team in Luxembourg, and with Geoffrey Chesty, senior manager in Ireland. We will discuss now about the Luxembourg business registers of the beneficial owners. The fourth AML-EU directive, as amended by the five AML directives, provide rules on the prevention on the use of financial systems for the purpose of money laundering and or terrorist financing. As you know, the Articles 30 and 31 of the fourth AML-EU directives introduce the requirement for each member state to establish a register of beneficial owner. Therefore, of course, in Luxembourg, the Luxembourg government has adopted the law of 13 January 2019 called the RBE law. RBE meaning in French, le registre des bénéficiaires effectifs. This law was published on 15 January 2019 in the Luxembourg Official Gazette, called also Memorial A. This law established an electronic central register of beneficial owner for the legal entities registered on the Luxembourg Trade and Companies Register. In addition of the law, on 15 February 2019, the Luxembourg government adopted the Grand Ducal Regulation prescribing registration modalities, administrative fees, as well as access to the register of beneficial owner. Further, and it's not the end, the Luxembourg Business Registers, called the LBR, being the manager, le gestionnaire, of the RBE, issued four circulars. The LBR also published an explanatory guide, or the guidelines, where they propose some methodology on how to identify beneficial owner and provide some examples of situation and explanation. If you want to find the version of this guideline, they are available on the RBE's website. It's important to note that the RBE law entered into force on 1st March 2019 and provides for a 6 months transition period to comply with these requirements. It means that all the company had to comply before 31 of August 2019. Just for the little story, I have read in a newspaper end of August that 61% of Luxembourg legal entities had yet to complete their duties for registration. It means that they have to register their beneficial owner and they have not yet done it. As a good news, for those who are late, on 29 August 2019, the LBR granted an administrative 3 month extension, meaning that legal entities have now until 30 November 2019 included to make their filings, which means also that registration and declaration to the RBE will be exempted from administrative fees until the 30th of November 2019 included. My colleague Hélène will provide you now with more details about the Register of Beneficial Owner in Luxembourg.
Good afternoon, everyone. So which corporate vehicles are concerned? So the law is covering only Luxembourgish legal entities. The Beneficial Owner's Register for Trust is partially addressed through a dedicated legislative process composed of, first, a law requiring trustees to gather information regarding the bills of trust for which they act as trustee, and a bill of law still pending that will actually implement the registry. The purpose of the register is to centralize specific information regarding beneficial owners of Luxembourgish legal entities and corroborating documents where applicable that are partially publicly accessible. The authority in charge is the Minister of Justice, and the register is managed by the Luxembourgish Business Register, or LBR, which is also the Luxembourgish Commercial Register. Regarding the scope of registered entity that must comply with the law, these are those including in Article 1.2 to 15 of the amended law of December 2002 regarding commercial and companies register, that include, for example, commercial companies, European economic interest groupings, subsidiaries of foreign entities, civil law companies, non-profit organizations, agricultural association, foundation, saving pension plans, public establishments, interest groupings, etc. Such type of legal entity can be of several legal forms, for example, public limited company, private limited company, etc. One of the key elements of this law is the definition of beneficial owner. The law refers to Article 1.7 of the Law of November 2004 as amended, which is the main law regarding AML in Luxembourg. Such definition comply with the directive 4-5-ML directive definitions. A summarized definition of the notion of beneficial owners is the following. So it is any natural person who ultimately owns or controls the customer and or any natural person on whose behalf a transaction or activity is being conducted. So a beneficial owner can only be a natural person. Regarding corporate entities, we have some specificities given in the definition, which is any natural person who ultimately owns or controls a legal entity through direct or indirect ownership of a sufficient percentage of the shares or voting rights or ownership interest in that entity, including through bearer shareholdings or through control via other means. A percentage of more than 25% plus one share shall be an indication of direct ownership. If no BO can be found at ownership or control level, the definition requires to identify the natural person who holds the position of senior managing official. That can be, for example, chief executive officer, chief financial officer, management or executive director, chairman, etc., depending on the type of company and the type of organization of such company. There is somehow this tendency to want to identify only the chairman of board members as unique beneficial owners. However, the LBR in its guidebook provides that the senior management officials are not only the chairman of the board members, but also include the management body of the entity. One of the pending issues regarding such definition is the question whether or not we shall identify one senior managing official, as it is currently requested by FATF 40 recommendation, or all persons that hold the senior managing official position that are required by EU standards and thus apply in Luxembourg. So there is this discrepancy between international and European standards. However, here again, the LBR in its guidebook specifies that if there is a person to whom the daily management of the company has been delegated to or equivalent, only such person must be recorded as beneficial owner in the register. So first, who must record the information? That is, who must provide information to the LBR? The main responsibility is on the registered entity itself or its proxy. The notary who drafted the constitutive or any amending act can also provide the information, but it is not mandatory. Second, which information must be provided? So the following information must be recorded and provided to the LBR. The name and forenames of the BO, full name and place of birth, country of residence, nationality, exact private or professional address, national or foreign identification number, and nature and extent of effective interest held. So such lists comply with one of the 4-5-ML directive, and such information must be accompanied by corroborating documentation. However, there is an exception regarding listed company. Indeed, if the legal entity is a listed company in Luxembourg or in an equivalent regulated market in terms of transparency, only the name of such market must be provided to the LBR. When to record the information? The registered entity or its proxy must request the record of such information or any updates up to 1 month after the event triggering such record. As we mentioned, only specific beneficial owner information are publicly accessible. The information that are only accessible to national authorities are, first, the private professional address, and second, the national or foreign identification number. Regarding searches on the register, the civil society can search by entity name and by company register number, but not by BO name, as it is only a prerogative for national authorities. The access to the RBO is secure and recorded. However, in no way a beneficial owner or the registered entity will be alerted when their page on the register is consulted. There is a possibility to restrict public access to beneficial owners' information. This is done on a case-by-case basis in order to limit the public access to BNO information only to national authorities, credit and financial institutions, and bailiff and notaries acting as public agents. The request must be duly motivated and documented. It must be justified by one of the legal cases authorizing the restriction of public access, which are, first, where such public access would expose the BO to a disproportionate risk, a risk of fraud, kidnapping, blackmail, extortion, harassment, violence, or intimidation, or where the BO is minor of age or otherwise legally incapable. As soon as the LBR receives the application to restrict access, the information are restricted until the LBR notifies its decision to the applicant. If the request is denied, access remains restricted during 15 days after notification. In case of appeal of the refusal, the access will remain restricted until the court decision. The length of the restriction of public access will depend on the ground justifying the restriction that we just mentioned. But it cannot be longer than 3 years. It can be renewed if a new motivated request is made 1 month before the expiration date. Regarding the appeal, any interested person may appeal against the supervisor's decision within the delay of 15 days following the publication of the notice restricting the public access. Along with the obligation to provide BO data to the LBR, registered entity and beneficial owners have additional obligation to provide information. On the BO side, the BO must provide to its legal entity information about himself or herself. On the registered entity side, it has first the obligation to collect and store BO's data and supporting documentation at its registered office, and for a record-keeping period of 5 years. If the legal entity is dissolved and thus removed from the commercial register, the legal entity must decide where to keep such BO data for 5 years after the date of dissolution. The second obligation imposed on the registered entity is the obligation to provide information regarding their BO, but also their owners, to national authorities when requested by a simple request. They must also provide information when requested by professional, but this time a motivated request must be filled, and the information must not have been restricted before. Regarding sanctions, there are several grounds for administrative fines, which are the failure to address a BO application request in the RBE, a failure to provide complete, accurate and current information in the register, a failure to obtain and keep BO's information at the registered entity's registered office, a failure to provide accurate and current information to national authorities and professionals, and finally, BO's failure to provide complete, accurate and current information to the registered entity. All such grounds for sanction will result in administrative fines from 1,250 up to 1,250,000 euros. There is also this obligation for any person having access to the register and noticing discrepancy to notify such discrepancy to the LDR. However, in this case, there is no sanction if the person failed to do so.
Thank you, Hélène. I will give you a little secret. We are receiving for the moment a lot of questions from our client in relation to the BO of the fund. Who is the BO of my fund? As we know, there are several types of funds, business channel used, distribution of private placement model, etc., etc. It's very complicated to know who is the BO of our funds. The Luxembourg Professional Association published a guideline with examples, that's only examples, on approach to identify the BO in investment funds depending on the distribution strategy. It's important to note that, as always in AML, there is no one size fits all solution. Each fund must be assessed on a case-by-case basis. It is to be noted also that the analysis must be conducted at the fund or umbrella level, meaning the legal entity, in case of sub-fund or multi-compartment funds. It's also essential to point out the fact that we are not liable for the content of the illustration examples, and that the ultimate responsibility to determine the beneficial owner stays with the board of the fund, the management company of the fund, in case of the fund is structured as a FCP, meaning a fonds commun de placement in French, or the associé or commodité gérant, or the general partner, in case of the fund is structured as a société en commodité simple, par action ou spéciale. I think that the best way in order to determine the beneficial owner of a fund is to apply a decision tree. And you have to ask you some question. I will give you one example. You have to ask you two questions in parallel. These two questions are, is there any natural person exercising control through ownership who ultimately has or have a controlling interest in my funds? And in the same time, you have to ask you is there any natural person exercising control through other means? What does it mean, other means? For instance, that they have the power to appoint or remove the majority of the board of directors, the management, the executive committee, for example. If the reply is yes, if you have any doubt, meaning that you have no doubt about the result of the question 1 and 2, the BO will be the natural person that you have identified. If the reply on these two questions is no, therefore, if you have no doubt about that, about the information collected, the beneficial owner will be the natural person who holds the position of senior management, senior managing officials. If you are not able to reply to this question, perhaps and surely further investigation might be required. We will know, as we have now discussed about this decision tree, we will not take some assumption and some examples. We'll see together some examples. We can take first the examples of a widely distributed fund. That's not in this slide. If the fund is widely distributed, if none of the fund investors exercise control through ownership, if none of the investor or any natural person exercise control through other means, that's the two questions that I have explained just before, therefore, as no BO or beneficial owner has been identified, the person to be inserted in the register of beneficial owner will be the board of the fund, if the fund is a legal entity, for instance, a SICAV. The legal representative of the MANCO, board or convicting officer in case of FCP, Fonds Commun de Placement, or the legal representative of the general partners if the fund is a société en commodité. We will take a second example. That's the one of the dedicated fund. If the fund is ultimately dedicated to a limited number of legal person or natural person, that's the purpose of creating a dedicated fund. If the fund has been launched for the above mentioned person, if one or several of these investors exercise control through ownership or through other means, therefore, the person to be included in the RBE will be all the investors of the fund. I repeat, all the investors of the fund who own or control through direct or indirect ownership of a sufficient percentage of the shares or voting right or ownership interest more than 25% or through control via other means. We'll now discuss about our third example. That's for the exchange traded fund, or commonly called ETF. If the fund is entirely or completely traded on the stock exchange with the obligation equivalent to EU directives 2004/109/CE requirement, therefore the name of the stock exchange and the country on which the fund is traded has to be included in DBO registers. And we'll take the examples of a fund with intermediary. If the shareholder register shows that they are positioned in the name of one or more intermediaries with more than 25% of the shares, of course, the intermediaries are investing on behalf of underlying investors. If for these intermediaries, the question has been raised to confirm that there are no natural person exercising control through direct ownership or means, therefore, as no beneficial owner has been identified, the person to be inserted in the RBE will be, as usual, the board of the fund if the fund is a legal entity, the legal representative of the ManCo in case of FCP, and the legal representative of the GP in case of Société en Commodité. We'll see now the examples of a fund of funds. Exactly the same question will be raised. The shareholder register shows that they are positioned in the name of an investment fund. In our examples here in the slide, we say the fund Charlie, which exercising a discretionary power over the investment decision. And therefore, the underlying investor of the fund Charlie cannot impact the investment decision. I will therefore make reference to the ESA's joint guideline, articles 219B. An analysis on fund Charlie shareholding is not required. There is no information on the identity of the underlying investors, because we are in a fund of funds. Therefore, neither the fund Charlie nor other natural person are exercising control through direct ownership or other means. Therefore, you have to report and record in the register of beneficial owner if the fund is a legal entity, the legal representative of the fund, if the fund is an FCP, the legal representative of the ManCo, the senior management, and if the fund is an SC, the legal representative of the general partners. We will go with our last examples because we can add a lot of other examples, but we'll stop it afterwards. That's the examples of the fund with limited distribution. If the fund is distributed to a limited number of legal or natural persons, none of the investors exercise control through ownership or through other means. As no BO has been identified, if the fund is a legal entity, it will be the legal representative of the fund. Same thing for the FCP, it will be the representative of the ManCo. And if the fund is a société or commodité, the legal representative of the general partners. The most important point for all this slide is that you have to ask you the two questions and try to reply to this question, and of course, or identify the beneficial owner, meaning the underlying investors or the investors, and if not, if it's not possible, you will record the senior management. My colleague Geoffrey from Deloitte Ireland will now present you the register of beneficial owner, but with an Ireland view. Geoffrey, that's for you.
Thank you, Bastien. Just by way of introduction, my name is Jeff Chastey and I'm a senior manager within Risk Advisory in Deloitte Ireland. Today, I wish to discuss the Irish experience of implementing a beneficial ownership register regime. Given the common basis in EU law for the Irish and Luxembourg regimes, and in the interest of time, I will focus on unique aspects of the Irish regime and areas of difference with Luxembourg. The Fourth Money Laundering Directive has been fully transposed into Irish law, mostly through the Criminal Justice, Money Laundering and Terrorist Finance Act, November 2018. The Fifth Money Laundering Directive has been partially transposed through statutory instrument and we wait for transition by January 2020. To begin with, corporate beneficial ownership register, since November 2016, corporates were required to maintain adequate, accurate and current information on their beneficial owners. Statutory instrument 110 established the central register of beneficial ownership of companies and industrial and province societies, administered by the Irish Company Registration Office. The initial go-live date for the RBO was the 22nd of June, which was pushed back to July 29th, 2019. Just to call out a unique aspect of filing with the Irish RBO, and that is the PPS number. Personal Public Service Number is an identifier issued by the Department of Employment Affairs and Social Protection. The PPSN is used to verify the information in the filing. In addition to Irish residents, any company director who owns more than 50% of the shares of an Irish entity or any shareholders who will receive dividends from an Irish registered company are required to obtain a PPSN. Where a beneficial owner does not have a PPSN, a BEN2 form can be completed, which is a declaration as to the verification of identity. When completed, the BEN2 results in the issuance of an RBO transaction number, which can be used in future filing with the RBO. The BEN2 must be signed by the beneficial owner and witnessed by a notary public. Since the inception of the RBO, a number of common errors have been identified, which result in the rejection of filings. These are PPS numbers, dates of birth, and naming conventions, such as the use of married names, maiden names, or traditional Gaelic Irish names. Access to the RBO is divided into two tiers. Tier one, unrestricted access to the RBO, provides unrestricted access to RBO data, and is provided to authorised officers of a number of organisations, including An Garda Síochána, which is the Irish National Police, the Irish FIU, the Revenue Commissioners, and the Central Bank of Ireland, amongst others. Tier 2 access is public access, which allows access to extracts from the RBO with limited information. These may be obtained by creating an account and payment of a fee of €2.50. Two points to be aware of. From these reports, the PPS number is not visible on any reports, and unlike Luxembourg, there's no application to restrict access to beneficial ownership information, except for UBOs who are minors. And to trusts, since January 2019, trustees have been required to hold adequate, accurate, and current information on the beneficial owners of the trusts on whose behalf they act. Beneficial owners include the settlor, the trustees, the protector, if any, the beneficiaries or the class of beneficiary, and any other natural person exercising ultimate control over the trust by means of direct ownership or other control. These registers are required to be made available to relevant authorities, which I've previously outlined, and Ireland has until March 2020 to have in place essential register. The register is expected to be maintained by the Irish Revenue Commissioners. Just to call out some of the challenges this causes, this poses to the fund industry. For a corporate fund, the fund itself, through its directors or their delegates, is required to maintain the register of beneficial owners of the fund. Taking account of the exemptions, the requirements in the corporate regulations apply to all types of corporate entities, including investment companies, establishments, UCITS or AIFs. The RBO does not have the ability to receive filings for ICAVs, that's Irish Collective Asset Management Vehicles, and it is proposed that the Central Bank of Ireland will maintain a separate register for ICAVs. For trusts, the duty to maintain the register falls either to the trustees, to the manager or to the operator, defined as the manager or any person who under the constitution or founding arrangements of the scheme is responsible for management of the property held for or within the scheme. This means that for an Irish unit trust, the management company is also subject to the requirements and should ensure that appropriate arrangements are put in place between them or with the trustees to ensure that they obtain the necessary information on beneficial ownership of unit holders to allow them to maintain and keep up to date the beneficial ownership register. This will obviously present a considerable undertaking for funds with large numbers of investors transacting frequently. The introduction of the RBO also places obligations on regulated institutions in the conduct of their business. Regulated institutions are currently required to notify the RBO of any discrepancies identified when carrying out CDD or in any other time in the course of business. They're not required as of yet to obtain an extract from the RBO when carrying out CDD. That requirement will be in place when the fifth money laundering directive is fully transposed. The extract can be obtained by the regulated institution from the RBO or from the client. In conclusion, the implementation of an RBO regime in Ireland has not been without its issues. We would hope lessons learned from the establishment of the corporate RBO will be used to smooth the process of establishment of ICAV and trust RBOs, and that the full transposition of the fifth money laundering directive will give regulated institutions a better understanding of their obligations. Before I hand back to my colleagues in Luxembourg, I would like to give a quick summary of the most significant enforcements seen in recent years by region and some recent trends. While these enforcements are at the higher end of the scale, or the highest end of the scale even, I believe it is important for the industry to be cognizant of the penalties for non-compliance. Traditionally, the US has been at the forefront of enforcement over the last number of years and has issued at least three enforcements in excess of $1 billion, and a number of fines in the hundreds of millions of dollars. As you can see from the slide, in 2015, BNP Paribas was ordered to forfeit more than $8.8 billion to the United States and to pay a $140 million fine. The bank was also sentenced to a five-year term of probation for processing transactions through the U.S. financial system on behalf of entities related to Cuba, Sudan, and Iran, all subject to U.S. sanctions. Fines issued by European regulators have not been traditionally as stringent as those in the U.S., however, that may be set to change, and the 2018 penalty issued by the Dutch public prosecutor may be an example of what is to come. ING Group admitted criminals had been able to launder money through its accounts and agreed to a €775 million settlement, which constituted a €675 million fine and a €100 million return of illicit gains. In APAC, the most significant fine to date was issued in Australia, where Commonwealth Bank agreed to pay a fine of $700 million Australian dollars following court-ordered mediation between the bank and the regulator, AUSTRAC. Commonwealth Bank admitted failures, including failure to report over 53,000 deposits in excess of 10,000 Australian dollars, and other failures in suspicious activity reporting and closure of suspicious accounts. Other enforcements we've seen in the last number of years, other enforcement actions include the appointment of government monitors to firms, and commitments by firms to remediate books of business. In Europe, under CRD5, prudential regulators have scope to take action, and relevant examples include orders to enhance capital buffers, removal of banking licenses, and a voluntary winding up. In conclusion, 2018 may prove to be a turning point for AML-CFT enforcement, particularly outside the US, and given current investigations underway in Europe, it may be only a matter of time before we see the first European enforcement in excess of €1 billion. Thank you for your time, and I now hand you back to my Luxembourg colleague.
will now discuss about the famous CSSF Circular 18698. And we will focus on the key element, key AML-CTF obligation for investment fund managers. As you may know, the CSSF issued in 1 year ago, in August 2018, the Circular 18698, repealing the CSSF Circular 12456 as amended. The circular applied with immediate effect, meaning in 2018, to UCITS management companies and IFM, as well as management companies subject to Chapter 16 and 17 of the Law of 17 December 2010, relating to UCI. Altogether, in this circular, they are called IFM, or Investment Fund Manager, or in France, GFI, for Gestionnaire de Fonds d'Investissement. In summary, because I will say in summary because this circular contains more than 100 pages. The circular, the CSSF circular set out the fundamental governance and organizational structures that are expected in terms of substance from Luxembourg investment management companies. The circular mentioned also the requirements in relation to governance, internal organization, substance. It's also one of the key elements, the substance, the policies and the procedures, the central administration. We'll come back a little bit later about that. The compliance, the internal controls function, and of course the fight against money laundering and terrorist financing, the operational function and technical infrastructures, as well as the key function such as delegated activities, the marketing, the internal administration and procedure, as well as risk management and valuation. We can see that these circulars cover more or less all the activities of an IFM. The circular provides also additional details and requirements in relation to the due diligence and the ongoing monitoring of the delegates. In terms of AML-CTF, because that's the purpose of our today's conference, the circular contains provisions which are not only applicable to IFM, but also to TA, transfer agent, or registrar agent. Let's go to concrete things. What are the key AML-CTF provisions included in the circular? The circular clarifies the general framework and obligation to which an IFM and also the TA, the registrar agent, are subject to with respect to AML-CTF. The circular is divided in two sections. Section 1 outlines the general framework applicable to IFM, irrespective of the function they exercise. The section 2 relates to the obligation applicable to the IFM and to the registrar agent, depending on the way in which the relationship with the intermediaries involved in the marketing of the fund and or such registrar agent are organized. In summary, the key AML-CTF requirement specified in the circular are: the IFM must be vigilant and comply with AML-CTF legislation in force. The IFM must implement and comply directly the new AML-CTF requirement, meaning as soon as they become applicable. And the compliance with this obligation must be subject to regular controls and testing. The IFM must also appoint an AML compliance officer at the senior management level and, based on the principle of proportionality, to appoint an AML-CTF officer. This function must be exercised by a person who has sufficient expertise and knowledge of the European and Luxembourg AML-CTF regulatory framework. This person must be a Luxembourg resident or has to be able to commute on a daily basis to Luxembourg, and they must be employed by the IFM. any change on this person must be communicated in advance to DCSSF. The AFM is also to monitor, and it's new. It's the first time that it's clearly writing like that. The AFM is to monitor the FATF publication and must, the word is important, must follow the guidance for the risk-based approach on the security sector issued by FATF in October, by the FATF, le GAFI en français, in October 2018. The AFM must implement the CSSF circular 17661, adopting the money laundering and terrorism financing risk factors joint guideline. This circular is key in order to perform a proper risk-based approach or risk assessment, which makes the link with the following point, that the concept of the risk-based approach is clearly mentioned in this circular, and each AFM is required to take appropriate measures to identify and monitor risk of money laundering to which it is exposed and take efficient and adequate measures to mitigate those risks. The AFM must implement the professional obligation directly and must perform regular monitoring and testing. The due diligence measures adapted to the money laundering risk have to be established and implemented with respect not only to the client, but also to its delegates, like, for instance, the portfolio manager, investment advisor, transfer agent, but also to the sponsor or the fund initiator, and the asset or investment of those funds. The due diligence to be performed on the asset is a very, very hot topic for the moment in Luxembourg. From there, we can say also that they have an obligation to perform an initial due diligence and an ongoing monitoring of the delegates, and that they have to keep it in writing. On a yearly basis, the AFM has to, the AFM compliance, has to issue an MLCTF report and submit it to the AFM governing body for approval, and must file this CSSF report within 5 months following the end of the financial year. The circular lists the minimum of the point to be covered in this report. I will not list everything. If the AFM delegates to third party the performance of AML obligation, the result of the due diligence of the oversight on the delegates and the terms of the agreement, including the roles and the responsibilities of each party, must be included in the report. For instance, the macro and the TA. Any change in the appointed delegates must be reported to the CSSF. It's not new, but on an yearly basis, the internal audit function is also required to report to the AFM government body to check the controls that they've made on AML-CTF tasks performed by the first and second line of defense, and must ensure that its recommendations and corrective measures are fully implemented. I will not enter in too much details, but the circular, but it's a key point. The circular mentioned 4 different scenarios and rules in respect of AML-CTF obligation, depending on the way in which the relationship with the AFM and the intermediaries involved in marketing and the registrar agent are organized. For each of the scenarios, for each of these 4 scenarios, the obligation to be followed by the AFM and or the registrar agent are specified as well as the level of the due diligence to be performed according to whether they have direct or indirect relationship with investors, marketing intermediaries, or performing the TA function. The key point here is that the AFM has to perform due diligence measures on those intermediaries and or direct investors for the scenario A. And he has to enter into a written agreement with those intermediaries. For instance, a distribution agreement with correspondent relationship, and provide a list of all intermediaries with whom the AFM has a direct relationship to the CSSF on an annual basis. He has also to perform due diligence, but I've already explained that, on the TA, when the registrar agent has been delegated to a registrar agent. And an agreement should be put in place. I will now give the word to my colleague Hélène. It will be the next point and the last point of our agenda, and she will discuss about the 5MLEU directive and its project of transposition into Luxembourg law through a bill of law number 7467. Thank you.
So what is the context of the 5ML directive? The 5ML directive has been published in June 2018 and repeals the 4ML directive. It is due to be transposed into national legislation next January 10th. So why a 5ML directive? The urgent need to take countermeasures in a new directive strengthening the provisions of the 4ML1 was mostly motivated by, first, the recent terror attacks on EU soil, revealing new financing trends, and second, to the vast financial dealings uncovered by the Panama Papers in 2016. As we can see on the slide, the scope of OBA identity and predicate offenses have been broadened over the IML directive. For example, the first directive of 91 was mostly dedicated to the criminalization of money laundering international legislation and confined predicate offense to drug trafficking as requested by the Vienna Convention of 88. The last predicate offense criminalized being tax crime by the 4ML directive. So we identified 10 main changes brought by the 5ML directive, and we chose to focus on 5 ones in green because they have a direct impact on professional obligations. So regarding other less direct effects of the amendment brought by the 5ML directive, in a nutshell, BO registers provision introduced by the 4ML directive have been further introducing more transparency. There will be obligation imposed on member states to introduce central mechanisms, such as register, to record from one end the identity of owners of bank accounts, payment accounts, and safe deposit boxes, and on the other end, the identity of owners of real estate. These registers will not be publicly accessible. The provision regarding financial intelligence units has been amended to foster effectiveness and efficiency, notably regarding cooperation. The cooperation between competent authorities within a member state and between different member states have also been broadened. So, regarding the last published bill of law in Luxembourg, I will try to make the connection between its current provision and the 5ML provision in the following discussion. The first change brought by the new directive is the extension of the scope of obliged entities with the inclusion of, first, providers in exchange services between virtual and fiat currencies, second, custodian wallet providers, and third, person storing, trading, or acting as intermediaries in the trade of work of art, either were carried out by art galleries and auction houses or by Freeport. However, this transaction must amount to a minimum of €10,000, and there is no definition of what is covered by art. All the three new obliged entities and the relevant directive definition attached to them are currently addressed by the Luxembourgish Bill of Law. Still regarding the scope of obliged entity, the pre-existing obliged entities regulation have been specified for two types of obliged entity. First, for real estate agents, they are regulated towards IML, including for their rental activity, for rents amounting to €10,000 per month. This amendment is currently addressed by the Bill of Law in Luxembourg. For auditors, external accountants, and tax advisors, The directive specifies that any other person who offers tax consultant services are also to be regulated. This amendment is not addressed by the Bill of Law in Luxembourg, but only because it is already provided by Luxembourgish law. Regarding amendments of the customer due diligence framework, the FIFA AML directive has introduced a new obligation to prohibit anonymous safe deposit boxes. The directive also specifies that the owners and beneficiaries of safe deposit boxes must be subject to customer due diligence before the 10th January of this year, or even before, if the safe deposit box is used in any way. The obligation to prohibit safe deposit boxes is addressed by the current Bill of Law, but not the obligation to subject owners and beneficial owners of such boxes to customer due diligence within a dedicated time frame. Another amendment regarding customer due diligence is the introduction of electronic identification means as a potential reliable and independent source that can be used as part of the obligation to identify and verify the identity of the customers. It also includes any other secure, remote, or electronic identification process regulated, recognized, or approved by the relevant member state. Regarding the obligation to identify and verify the identity of beneficial owners, the directive adds a new obligation in the case of senior managing officials identified as BU by default. In such case, the professional will have to perform the necessary reasonable measures to verify the identity of the natural person who holds the position of senior managing officials and shall keep record of the action taken as well as any difficulties encountered during the verification process. Both provisions are currently addressed by the Luxembourgish Bill of Law. Regarding the timing of identification and verification of identity, the directive specifies that the obliged entity shall collect proof of registration or an accept of the register for new relationship with legal entity or trust that are subject to beneficial ownership information as requested by Article 30 and 31 of the directive that implemented the BO registers. The directive also specifies the timing of performing customer due diligence to existing customer when the professional has a legal duty to contact the customer for the purpose of reviewing any relevant information regarding to the beneficial owner, or if the professional has had this obligation under the directive regarding administration of cooperation in the field of taxation. Such amendments are both included in the current Luxembourgish Bill of Law. Now, regarding amendment to the simplified due diligence framework, the threshold governing electronic money is again further reduced from €250 to €150, as from which customer due diligence must be applied. That means that first, the monthly reload amount, second, the maximum monthly payment transaction, and third, the maximum amount stored electronically shall not exceed €150. Regarding cash transaction, the threshold is again reduced from €100 to €50. And the directive adds the case of remote payment transaction with also a threshold set at €50. The possibility to increase the threshold up to €500 for national payments is repealed. Finally, the directive adds a paragraph regarding anonymous prepaid card by first, authorizing member states to ban such type of payments, and second, by requesting credit and financial institutions acting as acquirer to only accept payment carried out with anonymous prepaid cards issued in third countries where such cards meet requirements equivalent to those set in the directive article. Now, regarding amendments made to the enhanced due diligence framework, the FIFA AML directive introduces new enhanced due diligence regarding high-risk country identified by the Commission. We have either measures to be applied by obliged entity and measures to be applied by member states. Regarding enhanced due diligence to be applied by obliged entity, the following enhanced due diligence are mandatory to be applied for business relationship or transaction involving identified high-risk country. So obtaining additional information on, first, the customer and on the BO, second, on the intended nature of the business relationship, third, on the source of funds and the source of wealth of the customer and of the BO, and fourth, on the reason of the intended or performed transaction. It also includes obtaining the approval of senior management for establishing or continuing the business relationship, the first payment to be carried out through an account in the client's name with a credit institution with equivalent customer due diligence obligation, and increasing the number and timing of controls applied, and selecting patterns of transaction that need further examination. The following are also to be applied, but on a risk-based approach for transaction involving high-risk country in gray. The application of additional elements of enhanced diligence, the limitation of business relationship or transaction with natural person or legal entity from the third high-risk country, and third, enhanced relevant reporting mechanism or systematic reporting of financial transaction. Finally, member states must also apply measures regarding identified high-risk country that are, first, requiring increased supervisory examination or external audit requirements for branch and subsidiaries located in such country. Second, by requiring increased external audit requirements for financial group for any of their branches of subsidiary located in such country. Third, by refusing the establishment of subsidiary or branches in such country or otherwise taking into account the IML-CTF regime weaknesses. Fourth, by prohibiting obliged entity from establishing branches in such country or otherwise taking into account the IML-CTF regime weaknesses. And finally, by requiring to review and amend or terminate correspondent relationship with respondent institutions located in such country. All such provisions are included in the current Luxembourgish Bill of Law. Regarding the list of potentially high-risk situations introduced in Annex 3 of the 4th IML Directive, the 5th IML Directive has introduced new factors. Regarding customer risk, we have no third country customer national applying for residence rights or citizenship in a member state in exchange of capital transfer, purchase of property or government bonds, or investment in corporate entities in that member state. This provision refers to the so-called golden passport and golden visa, currently under scrutiny by the European Commission. Such golden passport and visa allow individuals to be granted nationality or residence title with no obligation of physical residence, nor a requirement of other genuine connections with the country except this type of investment. Regarding product, services, and transaction risk, we have first specified that electronic identification means are to be considered as safeguards and thus may lower the risk regarding non-face-to-face business relationship and transaction. And second, that transaction related to oil, arms, precious metal, tobacco products, cultural artifacts, and other items of archaeological, historical, cultural, and religious importance, or of rare scientific value, as well as ivory and protected species, are potentially higher risk. All such provisions are included in the current Luxembourgish Bill of Law. Finally, the fourth IML provision regarding protection given to employee that reports internally or to the FIU suspicion of money laundering or terrorism financing against threats or hostile action, and in particular from adverse or discriminatory employment action, is broadened by, first, a new right for such employee to present a complaint in a safe manner to the respective competent authorities and second, the right to an effective remedy to safeguard their rights. All such provisions are included also in the current Luxembourgish Bill of Law.
We are now having towards the end of our presentation discussion. If you have any questions, please feel free to type them in and we'll be happy to answer them. Or if you have any question or want to speak in a more detailed way about AML or financial crime topics, please do not hesitate to drop us an email or call us in our mobile. You can find our contact details in the slide number 2 with the agenda, where you can have our email and mobile phone. We were very happy to share with you this insight on AML KYC. Should you wish to, you will be able to have access to a recorded version of the discussion 24 hours after the session via the link provided in the email, in your email invitation. We hope that you have appreciated this webinar and that we'll have the occasion to meet again online during forthcoming session. Our next Link and Learn will be on 10 October and the topic will be Introduction to Risk Management. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.